you make a volcano in your kitchen, are the trillions of bacteria covering every bit of your body good for you? Let's find out. Welcome to Science at Six. My name is Millie, and I am this week's presenter in the centre. This is our very first episode, and we've got some great things to share with you. Each week, we have a different theme with activities, jokes, and challenges released every day online and through our magazine. In this show, released every Monday at 6 p.m, we'll show you our answer to the challenges. But you also get the chance to challenge us. Try our activities and challenges and get your thinking caps on, because you can ask us your questions and we'll try and answer some every week. You can find out where to get our activities in the description below, and you can email us your results and questions to openupscience@cambridgesciencecentre.org. This week, we asked if you could snuff out a candle without touching it. So here is a candle. We don't often say snuff out because we usually say blow out. So blowing out the candle will snuff it out and you don't have to touch it. But is there another way? There is one. Let's relight our candle. Now I need a glass. And now I'll place the glass over the candle. Our candle is burning. The wax is the fuel, the thing being burnt. But for burning or combustion to happen, you also need oxygen. When the wax burns, oxygen joins onto a carbon atom and forms carbon dioxide gas. There is lots of oxygen in the air, so normally the candle will run out of wax and never out of oxygen. But under the glass, there is only so much oxygen, and when that runs out, the wax can't be burnt, so the candle will go out. So, there you go. Two ways you can snuff out a candle without touching it. Now at the start, I asked if you could make a volcano in your kitchen. Well, one of my friends here at Cambridge Science Centre, Alex, is going to show you now.
Hello, my name is Alex, and I'm one of the science communicators from the Cambridge Science Centre. And today, we are going to be making a baking soda volcano. So, what we've got here is some baking soda. Also got some vinegar and some washing up liquid and some red food colouring. What's going on when the volcano erupts? The baking soda and the vinegar are going to react, and that is going to create carbon dioxide gas. We'll have some washing up liquid in there as well, and the gas, as it's formed, will form bubbles, and that will create our eruption for us. Red food colouring is just there for effect. So, first thing I'm going to do is pour in some of this baking soda. Got a couple of big chunks in there, which I'll just poke through. Right. Let's move that over here, move that there. Red food colouring can go into the vinegar. Nice. Right, let's pop that there. Washing up liquids. Not too much of this. Not too little either. Right. Let's see what happens when we pour some vinegar in. All right, 3, 2, 1. As you can see, we've had a nice explosion with carbon dioxide creating lots of big bubbles for our volcanic baking soda eruption.
Fantastic. Thank you, Alex. Don't worry if you didn't get all of that. The activity sheet for this volcano is available in the description. If you make your own volcano this week, please send us a video of it erupting to openupscience@cambridgesciencecentre.org. Now, Alex's volcano isn't how a real volcano works, with super hot rock exploding out of the ground, but it looks like one. So, what was Alex doing? Well, he made a chemical reaction. Vinegar is an acid called acetic acid mixed with water. Baking soda is a base called sodium bicarbonate. And when you mix these two, there is a chemical reaction that makes a new acid called carbonic acid. Carbonic acid isn't very stable though, which means it's going to fall apart. When it falls apart, it makes water and carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide was the gas our candle made when the wax was burning. Nothing is burning here though, and the carbon dioxide coming from the carbonic acid made bubbles in the washing up liquid, which is what erupted out of the volcano. Now, it's time to talk about something a bit different. Laura Weyrich is a paleomicrobiologist at the Pennsylvania State University in the United States of America. She spoke to my friend Andrew about the trillions of bacteria living on your body right now.
Hi Laura, thanks for joining me.
Hi Andrew, it's good to see you again.
So I've just been told that I have bacteria all over my body. Can you tell me what they're doing? Do I need to go and have another wash?
You do, you have trillions of bacteria and other microorganisms, these tiny little things that live inside of your body and on your skin and on top of your body. And in fact, these things are very beneficial. They're very good for you. They underpin your health. They do things like help us digest food and prevent infectious disease and even train our immune systems. So without them, we'd be pretty sick.
Okay, so definitely something I want to be keeping healthy on me. So you spend a lot of time learning about these bacteria. Why is that important for you?
These bacteria and other microorganisms that live on and in the human body underpin our health. And if we have the wrong set of them, we might have a disease. So understanding how and why they change and if they adapt to certain conditions is really important to curing and preventing disease. So I'm really curious to know how these things change over really long time periods, even from our ancestors through to today, and how they might change in the future. And in fact, I even think about these microbes on a daily basis when I'm making sourdough bread and letting the yeast or these microbes rise the bread up, or even when I'm in the garden and thinking about how microbes in the soil might help the health of my plants. These microbes really do underpin health in almost every aspect of the world.
Wow, so this is a whole invisible world that we can't see, but is really keeping the world we can see healthy.
You got it, Andrew.
So you have a team of people that you work with who help you learn about this. Does everyone in that team have the same background? Do they all have the same thing that they needed to do at school to be able to do this?
Absolutely not. I have a very diverse team of people from all over the world with very different histories, very different backgrounds, and very different educational opportunities available to them. So people with degrees in things like zoology or anthropology or archaeology or even microbiology and even chemistry sometimes come together and all work on the same problem. The more diverse backgrounds and knowledge we have, the better we are at solving problems.
So lots of different views on the same problem can bring out an answer that you didn't know about before.
That's right.
It was interesting you mentioned chemistry there, because our theme at the center at the moment is chemistry. So how does chemistry play into understanding these living things?
That's really interesting. Chemistry underpins how microbes eat, how they talk to other microbes, how they communicate with them, and also how our body might respond or interpret what these microbes are doing inside of us. So chemistry really is sort of the building block or the foundation for understanding what microbes are doing on a daily basis.
So you need all of these things to come together to be able to understand them. That's amazing. Well, I'm afraid that's all the time we've got, Laura. Thank you for chatting with me, and I hope to see you again soon.
Thanks, Andrew.
So there you have it. Most bacteria are actually really good for you. Now, Andrew mentioned chemistry while talking to Laura, and understanding chemical reactions helped us to put out the candle and make a volcano. This week, we're going to be looking at some more chemistry, this time something called pH. pH is how chemists measure how strong an acid something is. Alex's vinegar had a pH of 2 or 3. What does that mean? Well, check out our activities this week and find out. And don't forget to send in your questions and pictures and videos of your experiments. We'll have a look at some next Monday on Science at 6. Thanks for watching, everyone, and we'll see you next week. Bye.